Defenders of Islam insist it is a peaceful religion. Others disagree and point to the primitive treatment in Muslim countries of women and other minorities.
So let's discuss this now. We're joined now by Reza Aslan, a scholar of religions, professor at the University of California, Riverside, and the author of Zealot, The Life and Times of Jesus of Nazareth. Let's talk about this, because it's a very interesting conversation every time we have it. Before we get into this discussion, I want to play for you this clip from Bill Maher's show just this Friday night. Here it is.
President Obama keeps insisting that ISIS is not Islamic. Well, maybe they don't practice the Muslim faith the same way he does. But if vast numbers of Muslims across the world believe, and they do, that humans deserve to die for merely holding a different idea, or drawing a cartoon, or writing a book, or eloping with the wrong person, not only does the Muslim world have something in common with ISIS, it has too much in common with ISIS. There's so much talk, you can applaud. Sure.
He went on for a good 5 or 6 minutes about that, talking about how women are circumcision for women, not respecting the rights of women, not respecting the rights of gay people. And what's your reaction? And then we'll talk.
Well, I like Bill Maher. I've been on his show a bunch of times. He's a comedian, but, you know, frankly, when it comes to the topic of religion, he's not very sophisticated in the way that he thinks. I mean, the argument about the female genital mutilation being an Islamic problem is a perfect example of that. It's not an Islamic problem, it's an African problem.
Well, wait, because he says it's a, hold on a second, Reza, because he says it's a Muslim country problem. He says that in Somalia.
Yeah, but that's, and that's actually empirically, factually incorrect. It's a Central African problem. Eritrea has almost 90% female genital mutilation. It's a Christian country. Ethiopia has 75% female genital mutilation. It's a Christian country. Nowhere else in the Muslim majority states is female genital mutilation an issue. But again, this is the problem, is that you make these facile arguments like that women are somehow mistreated in the Muslim world. Well, that's certainly true in many Muslim majority countries like Iran and Saudi Arabia. Do you know that Muslims have elected 7 women as their heads of states in those Muslim majority countries? How many women
do we have as
head of states?
But for the most part, Reza, be honest though, for the most part, it is not a free and open society for women in those states.
Well, it's not in Iran, it's not in Saudi Arabia, it certainly is in Indonesia and Malaysia, it certainly is in Bangladesh, it certainly is in Turkey. I mean, again, this is the problem, is that you're talking about a religion of 1.5 billion people, and certainly it becomes very easy to just simply paint them all with a single brush by saying, well, in Saudi Arabia they can't drive, and so therefore that's somehow representative of Islam. It's representative of Saudi Arabia.
I mean, I think that Bill Maher's point is that these aren't extremists. We often talk about extremists and that we should crack down on extremists and why aren't Muslims speaking out about extremists. In Saudi Arabia, when women can't vote and they can't drive and they need permission from their husband, that's not extremists. Why aren't we talking more about what? That's not extremists, that's commonplace. Why don't we talk more about the commonplace wrongs that are happening in some of these countries?
It's extremist when compared to the rights and responsibilities of women, Muslim women around the world. It's an extremist way of dealing with it.
But it's not extremist in that. It's not extremist in that country in Saudi Arabia. That's the norm.
Oh no, it's not. I mean, look, Saudi Arabia is one of the most, if not the most extremist Muslim country in the world. In the month that we've been talking about ISIS and their terrible actions in Iraq and Syria, Saudi Arabia, our closest ally, has beheaded 19 people. Nobody seems to care about that because Saudi Arabia sort of preserves our national interests. Okay. You know, this is the problem, is that these kinds of conversations that we're having aren't really being had in any kind of legitimate way. We're not talking about women in the Muslim world, we're using 2 or 3 examples to justify a generalization. That's actually the definition of bigotry.
All right, fair enough. Let's listen to Benjamin Netanyahu at the United Nations today.
So when it comes to their ultimate goals, Hamas is ISIS, and ISIS is Hamas. And what they share in common, all militant Islamists share in common.
So Reza, the question at the bottom of the screen that everyone is looking at, does Islam promote violence?
Islam doesn't promote violence or peace. Islam is just a religion, and like every religion in the world, it depends on what you bring to it. If you're a violent person, your Islam, your Judaism, your Christianity, your Hinduism is going to be violent. There are Buddhist, marauding Buddhist monks in Myanmar slaughtering women and children. Does Buddhism promote violence? Of course not. People are violent or peaceful, and that depends on their politics, their social world, the way that they see their communities, the way they see themselves.
So, Reza, you don't think that there's anything more, there's the justice system in Muslim countries, you don't think, is somehow more primitive or subjugates women more than in other countries?
Did you hear what you just said? You said in Muslim countries. Mm. I just told you that Indonesia, women are absolutely 100% equal to men. Mm. In Turkey, they have had more female representatives, more female heads of state in Turkey than we have in the United States.
But in Pakistan,
stop saying things like Muslim countries.
Women are still being stoned.
And that's a problem for Pakistan. You're
right.
So
in other words, I just want to be clear on what your point is, because I thought you and Bill Maher were saying the same thing. Your point is that Muslim countries are not to blame. There is nothing particular, there's no common thread in Muslim countries. You can't paint with a broad brush that somehow their justice system or Sharia law or what they're doing in terms of stoning and female mutilation is different than in other countries like Western countries.
Mm-hmm. Stoning and mutilation and those barbaric practices should be condemned and criticized by everyone. The actions of individuals and societies and countries like Iran, like Pakistan, like Saudi Arabia must be condemned because they don't belong in the 21st century. But to say Muslim countries as though Pakistan and Turkey are the same, as though Indonesia and Saudi Arabia are the same, as though somehow what is happening in the most extreme forms of these repressive countries, these autocratic countries, is representative of what's happening in every other Muslim country, is frankly, and I use this word seriously, stupid. So let's stop doing that.
Okay, Reza, let's listen. I want you to listen to Benjamin Netanyahu again. This is actually the one I wanted you to hear.
Yeah, the ISIS.
But our hopes and the world's hopes for peace are in danger because everywhere we look, militant Islam is on the march. It's not militants, it's not Islam, it's militant Islam. And typically, its first victims are other Muslims, but it spares no one.
He's making a clear distinction there. He says it's not militants, it's not Islam, it's militant Islam. Do you understand his distinction there? Is he correct?
Well, he's correct in talking about militant Islam being a problem. He is absolutely incorrect in talking about ISIS equaling Hamas. That's just ridiculous. No one takes him seriously when he says things like that. And frankly, it's precisely why under his leadership, Israel has become so incredibly isolated from the rest of the global community. Those kinds of statements are illogical, they're irrational, they're so obviously propagandistic. In fact, he went so far as to then bring up the Nazis, which has become kind of a verbal tick for him whenever he brings up either Hamas or ISIS. Again, these kinds of oversimplifications, I think, only cause more danger. There is a very real problem. ISIS is a problem. Al-Qaeda is a problem. These militant Islamic groups like Hamas, like Hezbollah, like the Taliban have to be dealt with. But it doesn't actually help us to deal with them when instead of talking about rational conflicts, rational criticisms of a particular religion, we instead so easily slip into bigotry by simply painting everyone with a single brush, as we have been doing in this conversation, mind you.
Well, we're just asking the questions, Reza, and you're answering. I think you answered very fairly, and we appreciate it. Thank you, Reza Aslan.
We appreciate your perspective and helping everyone understand your perspective.
126 Muslim